Good evening. And to a greater or lesser extent, good evening and welcome to QI, where tonight we'll be delving into the seedy world of journalism. Before we start sexing up the facts, let's look at who's going to be on my press gang. Hold the front page, it's Shappy Kosandi! Drop the dead donkey, it's Ross Noble! Another world exclusive, Johnny Vegas! And personally responsible for eating Freddie Starr's hamster, Alan Davis. Now, before we press on, let's hear their buzzers. Shappy goes. That's newsy. Ross goes. Quite newsy too. Johnny goes. And Alan goes.
Very pleasing.
Oh, that's great.
So you've actually given.
It's a knockout, yeah.
You've given us the It's a Knockout theme.
Yeah.
So at any point we can play that and just wrestle around in that.
I could go.
Then every time I press mine, something terrible will happen.
Yes, well, yes,
there'll be news. Every time. I can't press my buzzer at all then, in case
there's a volcano has
tsunami.
Killed the population of Sunderland. Anyway, let's start. What kind of person lived here? Yes, already the tragic tones.
Initially, you think a very angry person that's quite small.
Yes.
Small.
It did genuinely exist, this Daily Mail model village. This was after the First World War when housing was in short supply and we were trying to build a land fit for heroes.
And it was made entirely of Daily Mail papier-mâché, was it?
Copies of the Daily Mail.
Well, the Daily Mail was never shy about trying to draw attention to itself with publicity stunts of all kinds, athletic stunts, firsts in aviation and so on. It was the Daily Mail that sponsored Amy Johnson to fly to Australia, for example, and they decided that they would lead the world because this was the way they ran in those days. And they thought they would contribute to a model village.
Well, I can see that. Like, if they go, let's have an air race, let's try and cross the Atlantic, and then they're all quite... Da-da-da, like, yeah, that. And, but then model village,
but then...
It's a sort of thing where, like, you know, Richard Branson said, right, I'm going to send a rocket to the moon and I'm going to take people. And they go, wow, Branson's amazing, we're going to fly.
And when we get there, I'm going to build a model village.
Yeah.
Well, I suppose you have to go back to after 1919, all those people wiped out by Spanish flu. Before that, all those people wiped out by the First World War. And the Daily Mail thought we needed a new modern Britain with new modern cities. And so they devised this village, which they thought were going to be absolutely marvellous. But the plans were a little overambitious, and they were overtaken by the...
Guardian Village.
the company who owned the land around and who named this new town Welwyn Garden City.
Oh.
Ah. But there it was, the Daily Mail model village at Welwyn Garden City, 1922.
It's a good job it wasn't the Sunday Sport model village, because then it would be the Welwyn Garden City.
Welwyn! Welwyn!
Check out the front of those houses. It's double fronted. Oh, look at the
And there's always
on.
The back alley too.
That is a rubbish model village. It's clearly full size.
Mm. Yeah.
Did the Daily Mail believe in giants and that there was a readership that they were missing out on? So they built a model village that was normal size, so giants would visit and go, oh, it's tiny. Oh, it's just, look at the attention to detail.
Don't forget, model has two meanings. There's model in the sense of it's a paragon, it's a model of its kind. And that's what they meant by it.
It's got three
Not
meters,
like it's
it?
A teeny
because
weeny.
Model village, everyone just walks around. There's also. Like,
yeah. The high street is called the catwalk. Yeah.
Everyone's just in their pants.
That's true.
I have to say, I weep when I think of my childhood and the amount of time we spent around a model village.
Oh, Beaconscott.
And what kids have today.
Yeah.
They've got so much, and my mum and dad would go, oh, look at that, it's Big Ben, but this big, and we'd go, wow.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, so your dad didn't drink. My dad would go to a model village, drink and go, I'm King Kong! And just start smashing stuff. How we'd laugh. You know why I can't go to model villages? Because when you walk round, because of the painted faces, they all look like people who've been, like, trapped by witchcraft. And
yes,
going,
they do.
Help! Get me out of here! I'm not really queuing for a newspaper. But when I come home, shrouded in guilt and drink... I don't know enough about the dark arts to make them all fully sized.
If only you could save them. The fact is, the Daily Mail's model village didn't work. They were bought up by the Welwyn Garden City Company, who eventually built 41 houses on the 6 acres and renamed it Meadow Green, so it was no longer Daily Mail Village. But Daily Mail, tell me about the Daily Mail. Who founded the Daily Mail?
Lord Beaverbrook.
Satan.
Not Lord Beaverbrook, that's the Express.
Express.
Satan is closer.
Oh. Was it just a load of beavers in a brook?
No, it's a family that still exists, it still controls the group.
Is it the Patak family?
No, it's not the Pataks.
That would be great.
That would be pleasing.
If we found out. They're little predated that. Spice Dynasty.
It was founded in 1896 by Alfred Harmsworth, who later became Lord Northcliffe. So Alfred Harmsworth was a great showman, and he had a brilliant gift for making Daily Mail readers think they kind of owned the mail. So he was always having competitions, asking them how the mail could be improved, for example. And there were people who wrote in and said, you should perforate your articles so we could tear them out like stamps, which is an interesting idea.
Are you sure that wasn't for toilet paper?
No. Someone else suggested that each page should be perfumed differently, so it smelt different.
And chip paper too. What if you confuse the chip paper with the toilet paper?
Madness would ensue.
Yeah. Yeah.
But before he was a press baron, he actually wrote a rather QI-style book, which had the marvellous title of Answers to Correspondents on Every Subject Under the Sun. The first edition contained articles with headlines What the Queen Eats, How to Cure Freckles, and Why Jews Don't Ride Bicycles.
Those three answers covered everything.
Yeah, well, those are the sum of the questions.
Oh, right.
But part of the showman in him was that he guaranteed that if you died with a copy of that book on you, your estate would get £200.
If you come from a family like mine, where they tend to drown themselves, that's the preferred... suicide.
Right.
So without scuba gear, how are you going to get down there to plant the book?
You said that's the preferred method.
Yes.
Got to do the old suicide, but oh God, we're
well,
not
there's,
near
been,
the,
there's been a couple of
the
sloppy
lake.
Ones.
Has that?
Yeah, caught themselves in dog food, you know, going to the zoo.
God.
I mean, the ones who really thought it through.
Oh dear,
you know,
dear.
It's not
dear.
Just been a last minute. Leaf. Lions!
Shouldn't it be cat food for the lions? You walk into the lions' enclosure covered in dog food.
Ross, they haven't thought it through.
I know.
Or else they'll drown themselves.
Do
you know in Japan?
Sand.
In Japan, sorry, yes. But in Japan, what they've introduced on the underground because of the delays of people killing themselves is the family get billed. And the further out of the city that you kill yourself by jumping on the version of the underground, the less money you have to pay. So everybody's been going right out to, like, High Barnet and places like that. Honestly, to top themselves
at
because
least
they don't
he
want
had
to leave
the chance to kill himself at Cockfosters.
Have you got any happy stories?
No.
You go to Clifton Suspension Bridge, there's a sign as you get to the bridge saying, with a phone number of the Samaritans.
Yeah.
Just in case anyone's thinking of jumping up. And then no telephone. Which really makes me think that if you are feeling that way, you're going to think, well, that's just typical of my luck.
Yes. Yeah.
Was there somebody... I might be making this up. He used to hang around at Beachy Head.
Yes, which is a common suicide
spot. And taught people out of
it. Yes, indeed.
There's priests walking around.
Yeah,
just going up,
priests
having
and
a
ordinary,
chat.
Ordinary, just good, kind people. Yeah.
But you know what the thing is about Beachy Head? If you, I've been on to Beachy Head when I say had a gig in Brighton and then gone. And if you just want to have a little sit down, and have a little think, yeah. People panic. I had priests come up to me. Yeah.
Because it is such a popular suicide.
Yeah,
spot.
I was just having a little bit of a read.
Yeah. Yeah.
And he came out. And well, to be, I think it was a bit attention seeking of me, if I'm honest. Well, to be honest, I was quite down.
You're dangling your legs over the edge.
Choking myself.
I'm fine. I'm absolutely fine.
Now, listen to this obituary and let me know what kind of person is being described. He was a tireless raconteur who gave colourful accounts of his exploits, but did not suffer fools gladly. An uncompromisingly direct ladies' man, he was affable and hospitable at every hour, but he did not uphold the highest ethical standards of the city.
Sounds like a bit of a wrong'un.
Yes.
Because they're all things that you kind of... See, I've got a problem with that expression, didn't suffer fools gladly.
You put your finger on it.
It's like, who does? Number one, who does suffer fools gladly? Who goes, oh, brilliant, there's a fool, I want to spend the weekend with them.
You have. You have, you're on my team.
No, you put your finger on it, Shabby. The point is, all those phrases are what used to be obituary code. And basically, you, to translate it, a tireless raconteur means
never
a crashing
up.
Bore.
Right.
Yeah.
Is it Nick Clegg?
It's not one individual, it's just these different things. Affable and hospitable at every hour, or simply convivial, a drunk.
Yeah.
Basically, a terrible drunk. Uncompromisingly direct ladies' man. A serial
hard.
Groper. Yeah. You'd also get devoted much of his time to the Boys' Brigade and the Boy Scouts. That also told you a lot about such figures. gave colourful accounts of his exploits.
Liar.
Liar, exactly. Did not uphold the highest ethical standards of the city.
Thief.
Yeah,
thief.
Fraudster, basically. Exactly. And did not suffer fools gladly.
Intolerant.
A total shit.
Yes.
Yeah, exactly. A howling shit. And these were the codes, and you read the obituaries, and you kind of understood what was being said about them. The longest Times newspaper obituary was 60,000 words. Who do you think for?
Was it the Queen Victoria?
Queen Victoria is the right answer. Oh. Well done.
Good
smart man. Very good. That's very good, very good. But can you name anyone who's actually read his own premature obituary? Has anyone ever read their own obituary while being alive?
There's a weird thing about, you know, when Frankie Howard and Benny Hill
yeah.
Died on the same day, and they rang up Benny Hill to say, can you, this is apparently true, right? Don't laugh like it.
I'm sorry.
This is death. I'm not inviting you to my funeral. No. And apparently they rang up Benny Hill to get a quote about the death of Frankie Howard, and his agent couldn't get a hold of him, so she made up a quote, but he'd already died.
Yes.
And he was at home, like, you know, in his flat, and then the TVs were already broadcasting his thing. Jesus. On the death of somebody else, and he was already dead.
That's such a typical agent thing, to not realise you're dead.
Yeah.
My wife used to work for an agency, and one of their clients, who was called Rory, passed away. But she mistakenly thought it was Rory McGrath. And so for about a week, every time someone rang for Rory McGrath, she'd say... I'm so sorry. And they would say, but I only saw him on Tuesdays.
I had a friend who ran a curve agency like that, and now ex-husband, who wasn't the most sensitive type, one of the clients... Sunday rung up and rang the house and obviously said she'd passed away. And he just left a note on the fridge saying, like, Mrs. Johnson, brown bread. And so she went shopping.
Oh, no! Horrible.
No, she needed groceries.
Oh, dear. Well, there are two stories. One was that Alfred Nobel read his own obituary and was described as being a merchant of death because he invented...
Dynamite,
yes, exactly. And he was so horrified, and he wasn't dead, that he instituted the Nobel Prizes in order to try and reclaim his name. But that is not, in fact, a true story, but it's a myth The other one is Marcus Garvey, the Jamaican black nationalist, apparently died as a result of reading his obituary. He had a stroke when he read the Chicago Defender newspaper, which printed his obituary describing him as broke, alone and unpopular.
Oh!
That's terribly sad.
It's like Googling yourself.
Yeah.
Mine would just say, it's safe to come out now.
Yeah.
He's gone, honest.
It would have friends who knew him said, yes, he really was like that.
I did say the other day, I was driving through Islington and there was a hearse slowing everything down, and I did say to my wife, if it's my funeral, tell the poke driving the hearse to step on it. I would not.
You should, instead of having a coffin as well, just have the body, so there's a going around the corner, you're slamming against it.
Chickens in a cage, you know, some boxes to drive through, just make it
like an A-team final.
Yeah.
What music do you want your coffin to go? When your coffin goes into the disappears.
The Sweeney theme.
That would be a good one.
The end music, you know, when it's really slow.
When the foot presses on the accelerator.
I quite like the music from Allo Allo with You Have Been Watching.
Well, you know, one of the most popular ones is the countdown theme.
when my dad died, he's a big fan of sailing, so we gave him a Viking send-off. We put his ashes in a boat and tried to set fire to it, but because it was in the North Sea, it wouldn't light. So what we did was we were trying to fill the boat full of his ashes, and we're going, do you tip the ashes straight into the boat or do you put them in bags? And my mum, who's ever the practical, she went, I've got some sandwich bags. I'll get some sandwich bags. So we packed him in the boat, and then we went out to sea, and off he went and shot off into the distance.
Was it a remote control boat?
It was a remote control, like a proper big yacht. And I just,
You set your dad off with four double A's.
Yeah, we did. Just...
You're there with an air rifle.
Hey,
like that.
The people from the miniature village were going, help that man, someone help me.
The little lifeboat comes out.
Did you not argue over who used the remote control? That wouldn't work in our family. Give it here, you're doing it wrong. It was my dad too. Give us a go.
The word dignity is not the first in your...
No, but this is the thing. That's exactly what he would have wanted, and I've said the same thing. Like Hunter S. Thompson, you know, when he died, Hunter S. Thompson was put in a cannon and just fired off across the valley that he used to own. And what I'd quite like to do is I'd like to be put in, like, pepper spray, and then, you know, just people that I don't like, I'm going to get my wife to go, like that. That's for a noble!
Oh, my God, how did we get here? I can't even remember. The fact is, no matter how many character flaws you have, you can be sure that they'll be euphemistically dealt with in your obituary. Journalists are not above a bit of muckraking, of course, but can you describe the most expensive piece of shit to come out of a British bank?
Is it some sort of fossilised... dinosaur poo in the...
How extraordinary you are, Ross Noble. For 20 minutes, you've been gibbering like an idiot. Suddenly, you've come up with a brilliant answer. You're absolutely right. The only way to be right is if you could give me a technical name for fossilised shit.
Is there going to be feces in the thing?
Well, you can call it, yes, you can call it paleontofeces. Or you can call it coprolite. It is copra shit in Latin.
Coprolite sounds like a chocolate bar.
It does rather, doesn't it? It's not a very nice one. But there was a Lloyds Bank in York, of all places, and they found this period poo in 1972. It was 23 centimetres long, 5 centimetres wide, a human poo. It was a Viking poo.
Did you find this within the bank? call was this on a... I'm checking it was a staff day out.
It was found under the branch. They found it somewhere. This sort of stone hanging down.
To be honest, it just looks like an old Watsit to me.
It does, but when you examine it more closely, you will see that it is a poo, and you can actually even determine what was eaten, and that is cereal bran. So they were quite healthy and regular, and hence the... Well, I wouldn't say it's the most normal-looking stool I've ever seen, but...
So you're telling me that every time I go to the loo, I am flushing away millions?
Potentially...
In future, I'm going to go to my bank and have a shit there. But I'm going to tag it so that my family in future...
He's just going to walk in here. I'm just going to make a deposit.
Yeah, yeah.
Whose discoverer, Andrew Bones Jones, said this is the most the most exciting piece of excrement I've ever seen. In its own way, it's as valuable as the crown jewels. There was another exciting coprolite that was discovered. It was a T-Rex turd. It was found in Saskatchewan in 1998. And that was 17 inches long and 6 inches thick. And that was reckoned just to be a bit of it knocked off, that the actual turd would have been even bigger.
How did they know? Was there a dead T-Rex next to it that had pooed itself to death?
No, it was found reaching for the toilet roll with its tiny claw.
How does it
work? Oh, more T-Rexes died of frustration because they couldn't get round to wipe.
Coprolites are not everybody's, you know, cup of tea collecting fossilised turds, but...
People like poo, though.
They do like poo,
don't they? They do like poo. They like drawing with poo. I went to someone's house and they had, like, this elephant poo painting.
But when communication breaks down, it does make a bold statement within laws. When you write something on the wall like, call me a taxi... They do it, honestly. You're like just one of them parties where you've had enough. You write on the wall with your own feces. People start listening to you. You've just got to do one big enough to go, I was not fond of the cheesecake. I'm considering you are out of vodka and I am low on turd. I would like to go home now.
The odd thing is when the forensic scientists come in and they find out that it was Johnny Vegas' poo, but it was Lorraine Kelly's handwriting.
Yeah, but the diction was perfect, and even the sweet corn was used for little commas.
Oh. Oh, now. Now, there's the line. We found the line.
You've crossed a boundary.
Are you finding that you're not selling as much Tupperware at these parties? I don't mean to keep it in that area, but I will. My wife once had, you know, those bath bomb things? You know those?
Oh, like, yes, yes.
She had one of them in the bath. Yeah, and it fizzes up. Las grenades, I call them. You chuck them in a bath and they fizz up and they fill the bath full of glitter. And I didn't realise, went in the bath and quite a lot of glitter had gone in me bum. And I didn't realise, and I did a poo and I looked into the toilet and it was sparkling, right? It was... And I honestly, for a minute, I thought I had a magic arse. I honestly did.
Yeah. That was lovely. That's a beautiful story. Anyway, moving on. What's the name of the highly fortified building where most of the gold in America is kept?
Oh, no, don't do it, don't do it.
Yes. Beckham's house?
The Beckham house is a good answer. Most of the gold in America is kept in a single place.
Is this a double bluff and it is going to be Fort Knox?
It's not Fort Knox. No. Nearly twice as much gold is at the Federal Reserve Bank in New York, which is their equivalent of the Bank of England. They have there about 7,000 tonnes of bullion, and in Fort Knox, they've got no more than around 4,500 tonnes, which is not quite half.
A pittance.
But it's still a lot. But they've had some interesting things in Fort Knox, apart from gold. They've had one of the great English treasures, if I were to say...
Thora Heard.
I'll say the year 1215 to you, does it?
The Magna Carta.
Very good. They had the Magna Carta in Fort Knox for some short time. They also stored the crown, sword, sceptre, orb and cape of St. Stephen, King of Hungary, was stored there and then returned to the government in Hungary in 1978.
Was it like a cloakroom? Did he come in? Go, all right, take the cape, there's me home.
And then lost his ticket and they wouldn't give it back.
Really annoyed.
Honestly, I'm the king of... Let me try the crown on, it's a perfect fit, I promise.
And where does Spandau Ballet fit into the whole equation?
They're like the Rasputin of the new government.
Is there something I'm missing out here?
There's... Goal!
Goal! Can...
Oh, it's always believing.
Let's sing that and run at him.
You're indestructible. Always believe it.
I'm just going to move on to the next question, if I may, which is, can you think of a way of promoting railways that is guaranteed to get into the papers? Yes.
Make them work.
Ah, very good. Bravo. I like that. Good answer.
Crash.
Crash them.
You're right. You get the point.
You're joking.
No, I'm not.
I just saw Branson and thought, crash.
Yep. Make them crash. Fun enough, a man called Crush was a rail magnate in America, and in order to draw attention to what he thought was his supreme, splendid line across Texas, he arranged for this public display of two trains charging into each other. They were either end of a four-mile track. Then they began to accelerate, and then they collided to great cheers. However, both boilers exploded. Metal began to fly. Spectators ran in blind panic. Two young men and a woman were killed. At least six other people were seriously injured in the flying debris.
That's not death. That sounds like something today.
Branson would attempt, doesn't it?
Yeah, well,
it sounds to me like Thomas the Tank Engine does Die Hard.
Yeah.
Thomas and Percy were flying towards each other in some horrific showdown to the death.
The last moment.
The Thomas and Tank Engine video game at the 18 certificate.
Yes.
Grand Theft Thomas. Thomas went chugging down there. He killed a prostitute for extra.
I very much like this idea. We must write this down.
That's good. You can have that idea. Other ways of trying to get publicity for things. Honoré de Balzac, the great French writer, he wrote a play. It's called Les Rubriques de Quinola. And his way of drumming up real attention for it was to tell everybody that it was sold out. Unfortunately, this rather backfired, because everyone thought, oh, there's no point in me trying to buy a ticket. It's apparently sold out, I can't go and see it. So it was a complete failure.
There's a brilliant novel by Ted Heller called Funny Men, and it's about a fictional comic double act. And in one of their shows, someone had a heart attack, and they came upon this brilliant publicity scheme where they would have ambulances waiting outside the theatre. So it was so funny. It was almost certain that someone would have a heart attack and die. And then they would have people feigning heart attacks and being ferried off in ambulances.
That happened at one of my gigs. A girl was laughing so much, she had a really bad asthma attack. And that's a dilemma, because on the one hand, you're thinking, that's terrible. But on the other hand, you're thinking, yeah.
Yes! Nearly killed one.
I killed one.
I killed them.
That one's dead. Yeah. 999 to go.
Exactly.
Now, some people will do anything for fame, but what did the famous five have lashings of?
Ginger beer.
No!
Someone has to say it. Oh,
I read all of those books. I'm gutted that I don't know.
It's funny, because in the books, there is only one foodstuff that is referred to in all the famous five books, of which they had lashings.
They eat the dog.
Give me the dog, no.
Asbestos. They had lashings of asbestos. But they realised just how dangerous it was in powdered form.
The dog in Famous Five was asbestos.
Timmy. No, no.
No, not the dog.
Oh, sorry, I thought the dog was asbestos.
They were just pat lots of asbestos for its
asbestos
fire retardant qualities.
Is a very good name for a dog.
It's great, isn't it?
No,
asbestos!
The reason you...
Asbestos!
The reason
my uncle had a dog named after Charlie Mingus, the jazz musician.
Yeah.
And he would cut Mingus. But the problem was is that he's got the same accent as me. You'd be in the park and he'd just be shouting, Mingus! Mingus! And the local girls thought that he was... Mingus! Piss off! Mingus! Call him Mingus, and it led to all sorts of problems.
I'm sure it did. Why do we think of, it, of the lashings of ginger
because
beer?
Because of the comic strip.
Because the comic strip presents off. Their first film was the comic strip presents Five Go Mad in Dorset, and they kept going on about having lashings of ginger beer. But in the actual books, there's no reference to lashings of ginger beer. But in one of the books, Five Go Down to the Sea, they did arrive at a Cornish farm and immediately settled down to a high tea of lettuce, tomatoes, onions, radishes, mustard and cress, carrot grated up, and lashings of hard-boiled eggs.
Eggs! Yeah. Oh, I was going to say
you were going to say that. They're the only
They're
lashings that Enid Blyton gave the famous five were lashings of hard-boiled eggs. They never had lashings
That's
of ginger beer.
That's a terrible picnic. That's onions.
It's very hard to lash an egg. Well, unless you're in some sort of S&M thing with Humpty Dumpty. That's why they couldn't put them back together again.
No, I would give you 10 points if you can give me within three the number of books that Enid Blyton wrote a year.
42.
You were damn close. You were just out of range, I'm afraid. She actually wrote 37 books a year. And talking of busy women, let's move on to another question here. Why have we never heard of Harriet Quimby? You've heard of Fred Quimby, who produced the
Tom and Jerry.
And Mayor Quimby in The Simpsons. But Harriet was the first American woman to become a licensed pilot and the first woman to fly the English Channel. But unfortunately, it just so happened her record-breaking flight didn't make the news because she completed it the day after the Titanic sank. So it just was a damp squib, to say the least. She was famous in her day. She was one of the very first screenwriters at the very beginning of Hollywood. She wrote seven scenarios for the father of cinema, D.W. Griffith. She died aged 37 at an aviation meet, sadly crashing. But it was an impressive and a short and brilliant life. Who was the first man to fly the Channel, do you remember?
Oh, we all know him. We all know the men that fly the Channel. I don't.
Well, he was the first person. Louis Blériot, it was one of the great achievements. He flew from England to France, but the French authorities, when he landed, didn't have a form, and so they signed him in as having landed on a yacht called Monoplane, because that's the best they could do. But it was a huge feat at the time, and it was a £1,000 prize offered by...
The Daily Mail?
Of course, the Daily Mail. Well,
but you know what? Harriet did that backwards and in heels.
Exactly. Very good. Good point.
Thank you.
I'm sure it was harder for her. But it can be... it can be very difficult to die at the wrong time. Who can you think of people who died, unfortunately, on the same day as somebody even better known than themselves?
There's some good examples. Oh, I know. Mother Teresa.
Yes, who died on the same day as...
As Diana.
Precisely.
The Princess of Wales.
So she was not only below the fold, she was over the page.
I only realised, like, a couple of months ago, Mother Teresa was dead.
Yes, yes. Who died on the same day as Michael Jackson?
It was an actress, wasn't it?
Yes, an actress.
Farrah Fawcett.
Farrah Fawcett is the right answer. Well done. Summoned up from nowhere.
I've just found out this moment that Farrah Fawcett's dead.
Oh, you didn't know that?
I had no idea.
She died on the same day as Michael Jackson.
Yeah, exactly.
apparently, when the ambulance men were driving up Michael Jackson's drive, they've heard he wasn't breathing, and they're driving up there, and one goes, what are we going to try first? And the other one went, I reckon the roller coaster. But you do that thing where if you're on a plane and there's somebody famous on there, you look at them and think, this goes down, who's going to get the top of the bit?
I have to say, I haven't yet thought that. That would be a sad thought, wouldn't it? Would I get the headline?
I was on a plane with Sting once.
Well, Sting and Alan Davis go down would be, I don't know.
In Australia.
Sting and Jonathan Creekman. That's unfortunate.
And they're going in this internal flight in Australia, so not a long flight, and he knelt on his seat talking to the person behind him the whole flight, so everyone on the plane could see him for the whole. And he didn't do a single song, not one song.
Oh.
Was he not just doing yoga? He was sat there, but his head was fully... fully rising.
Finally, 22nd of November 1963. Who died then?
Kennedy.
Right, so JFK, that was obviously huge news. An American president died. As it happens, two very distinguished authors died on the same day. Both British, as it happens. C.S. Lewis and Aldous Huxley both died on the same day as Kennedy, so both got rather tiny-whiny little obituaries. Now, how can you get a German on your side before he's even had his cornflakes?
Allow him to put his towel over them first.
That might definitely do it. This is a reference to a very specific operation in the Second World War, and it was called Operation...
Cornflakes.
Operation Cornflakes, exactly.
Put the milk in the bowl first, because it's more...
Maddens them.
Does it?
No.
Really? You can tell me anything now and I'll believe it.
This was an ingenious method of distributing Allied propaganda. What they'd do is a bomber would bomb a mail train in Germany, and a second plane would come along and drop tons and tons of fake mail addressed to real German addresses that was filled with anti-German propaganda. And the stamps, some of the stamps were even, you can see the one on the far right, where they looked so like the real one. That says Futsches Reich, ruined empire, and it has Hitler as a skull, and those were the normal stamps that the German Empire had at the time. A group in Rome prepared envelopes with more than 2 million names and addresses, and the whole point was that the train had appeared to be derailed, and the people had come to rescue all the mail, and they'd see amongst it these mailbags that were identical to proper German postal mailbags that had been dropped by the second Allied bomber, and they were in fact addressed to hundreds of thousands of people, telling them they were losing the war, that Hitler was lying to them. It was known as Operation Cornflakes because they opened their letters with their cornflakes, as it were. I thought it's quite interesting, didn't you?
Quite interesting.
But it's time, I think, for a dubious theory.
A dubious theory from Stephen Fry.
Yes. According to Dutch writer Iman Wilkins, the Trojan War actually took place in England, near Cambridge. The area which Homer calls Crete was Scandinavia, Sparta was Spain, and Lesbos was the Isle of Wight. Dubious or not, read out the arguments at trojanschmojan.co.uk and then decide for yourself.
Dubious theory from Stephen Fry.
Is that a website that's been set up by the elves?
Yes, it is. It is. But it basically assembles all the facts which people who genuinely adhere to this theory that the Trojan War really does not seem to qualify for a Greek war. For example, there's no mention of any Greeks anywhere. Troy's attackers are referred to as Danaans and Achaeans, who could be Danes, could be people from Argos, a kingdom of northern France. And Homer's Troy also has a climate which is very un-Mediterranean, full of storms and wind and rain.
Stephen, were this true,
yeah,
would we not have relics all around East Anglia, swords and helmets and that kind
of thing? And a massive rotten old horse.
And a rotten old horse, exactly.
In Cambridge city centre.
Exactly. There are counter-arguments, and most people will believe that it is dubious. Sanakkale in Turkey is generally believed to be the archaeological site of Ilium or Troy, but there are serious historians who maintain that Homer was writing about a Trojan War that in fact took place in Britain, in East Anglia, would you believe? All right, what kind of hat did they wear in the Wild West?
10-gallon hat.
10-gallon hat. Oh.
5-gallon hat?
No.
Oh, no, of course, because now it's litres, isn't it?
So, no.
Yeah. 45 litres.
No litres or gallons.
Was it a Stetson?
It wasn't a Stetson. No. The most popular hat by far in the...
A cap, a flat cap.
No.
It was the bowler hat.
Yes, a bowler hat is the right answer. Far away. There we are. We think of the bowler hat as the British businessman, but in fact it was the preferred hat in the West. And that's a pretty wild bunch there. Butch Cassidy, seated front right. Sundance Kid, Harry Longbow, of course, front left. In fact, their pride in having their photographs taken with those hats was their undoing, because the Pinkerton agency reproduced the photographs and gave it to their agents who tracked them down and killed them. It was hatmakers Thomas and William Bowler who created the hat, but they weren't known as bowler hats in America, nor are they to this day. What did they call them? Derbies or derbies, yes. Bowlers basically were much more common in the Wild West than Stetsons. Who fancies a shootout with a real-life vortex cannon? I've given you one each next. You've got a box. See that box there? It's simply a box, all right? Now, the hole is where the vortex emerges. So if you lean it so that the hole is pointing at the target, all right, and basically what you're going to do is smack the side of the box, all right? After a 3, 2, 1, smack! Very good. There you are! Now... What are you doing? But what we can... Yes? What we can do before you destroy the box... Before you destroy the box, you can do something even more exciting, and that is fill it with smoke, and it will demonstrate what, in fact, was happening with the air. You should all have smoke machines. That's it. Fill it with smoke, fill it with smoke, fill it with smoke, and now... Look! Look at that! Just a gentle tap. That is a vortex, a beautiful smoke ring, and... A lovely one there. And I've got an enormous cannon here. And I'm going to fill mine with. I'll see if I can get mine across the. Across the.
You can't even chase each other.
Across the room here. Here we go. I've got the wrong way around. But let the smoke drift a little. We don't like a big dustbin. It's simply pressure of air creating this wonderful vortex.
No, it's not. It's magic.
Nice one, Alan.
Hey, with this kind of magic, we could make the tiny people big again.
Yes. Basically, ladies and gentlemen, that's it. Hours of fun can be had playing with your own homemade vortex. And I suppose it must be time now for me to give the scores. And how interesting they are. In first place, with -5, is Ross Noble. Second equal, with -6, Alan Davies and Johnny Vegas. And a slightly unhappy Shappy with -17. Lovely smoke rings. Lovely smoke rings. So that's all from Shappy, Johnny, Ross, Alan and me. And I will leave you with this from Abraham Lincoln. The trouble with quotes taken from the internet is that you can never know if they're genuine. Thank you and good night.
More comedy and quizzing with an added dose of music on BBC HD at 10 o'clock on Monday. That's in Buzzcocks. Next night, though, we're heading into the thick of it.